the equivalent of Rage was on. And the Rolling Stones came on, and they were playing a song from their album Black and Blue. And I said to Bill, you know, just thinking of Black and Blue, thinking, you know, Bill, it'd be great if we could have an Aaron Siskind exhibition. And he said, you know, I've got Aaron Siskind's phone number upstairs. I said, go and get it, Bill. So I ran up the stairs and got it. I said, let's ring him. So we rang him, and we arranged the exhibition. And by the time we had arranged the exhibition, finalized the whole thing, the same Rolling Stones song was still playing on Rage. So there was something about the photographer's gallery that enabled us within 3.5 minutes to organize a show by someone who had the very, very best of international reputations. And I'm going to talk about myself for a minute, 10 seconds. Life sort of goes into chapters. And you think of the chapter of the photographer's gallery. And God, I was blessed. I was blessed by the people who took part in the whole mad, wonderful project. When Ralph Gibson came, on the first day when Ralph Gibson was there, we had a coffee with him in Lygon Street. And he said, how come I'm here with you guys? He said, they want me in Berlin. They want me in Tokyo. But here I am, you know. He said, the glass on your table in the photographer's gallery is only that thick. He said, I'm used to galleries where the glass is that thick. And, you know, how come? Bill was fantastic. Ian, do you think we should... I'm sorry. So, you know, as someone who just, like... I was estranged from Bill for, I don't know, 11 years or something. And, but, without a doubt, he was my best friend. And I will never, if I live to be 200, have an experience like that again. So I thank you, Bill.
You guys watching the funny.
I want to tell the facts, look, it's very, very quick.
Right.
One of the great things that Bill did was to come back with the name of William Clift and said, let's have a William Clift show, this guy's good. Yeah. And so, sure. And let's do it, Bill. And so we were doing it and doing it. And it was about 16, 17 days to the opening of the William Clift show, and we had no prints. There were no prints that arrived from America. And we were, as they would say, packing death. So, you know, do we contact this person and say, I think your prints are lost. And we had no idea what to do. And then we received a phone call from a farmer. From a farmer out the back of Danville. And he said, I've just bought a tractor. I said, oh. He said, I wasn't going to open the tractor, but we opened the tractor. And there was a box inside the tractor crate.
Oh, my God.
And it said, photographs from William Clift for the photographer's gallery. Yeah. And we'd always have to go and say, they say, what are these photographs? You have to pay 40% duty on them. And we'd have to say, oh, no commercial value. We're just going to use them for our teaching, you know. I know it says Victoria and Albert Museum on the cover, but none of these photographs have any commercial value whatsoever.
Posters.
And it was like one of these things that happened every month in your life. You know, you'd have to go to the airport and convince someone to let this box come through. I can tell you this now because it's more than 7 years since that has happened, and that law that we broke, I think, is...